Now, with you painting for fishermen, that's a niche of a niche. We're fortunate that we're in a time, an era right now, that it's the niche market. Because of the internet, we can reach out to all these niches. And so people that really want to become professional painters, they're kind of afraid because they see all of that out there. And they want to be part of it. And it's so overwhelming that they don't do any of it. So if you want to become a professional artist, the idea is to sit down and ask yourself, who is it that I am? What do I like to do? Because chances are, if you like to do something, millions of people like to do that thing. You're not that unique. You like to think so. Oh, you are. You're unique. But in the big scheme of things, but you like to, I didn't know you like fly fishing.
I do.
Yeah, it's kind of a passion. So, you know, and so if you can sit and do a painting and make the viewer feel like they're there. Like I said, you've got to be able to make the viewer feel like they want to be standing in a river and doing that. The awesome thing about the way the world is right now is that you could just say, I'm just going to paint that the rest of my life. You don't get bored because it's something you love. So you got to find something you love. I love landscapes. Above that, I love nature. And I sat for a while asking myself, so if I could paint anything in this world, what would that be? What would that be? If I could paint anything in this world, what would that be? And if I was told I could only just paint that thing forever, what would be the subject matter? How would it be painted? And I did this experiment almost like last January. I really sat in my studio and asked myself, looked at a blank canvas, and I said, how would I paint something without any agenda? What would it be? Would it be a landscape? Would it be nature? Would it be a still life? Would it be a portrait? What is it when I go through Facebook? What do I have the most pictures of? You know, when I go through other artists' work, I save. So I scan through my phone. And you'd be surprised. You want to know who you are? Scan through your phone. Just go and just look at all the imagery. Chances are you're going to find you in there somewhere because you're attracted to certain things. Like you like doing comforters. Was it quilting, right? I don't own a photo of a quilt anywhere in my life. And I bet if I go to your house, you probably have file cabinets full of photos of quilts and other people's quilts. And yeah, hard drives full of it, yeah. It's like you come across all your friends on Facebook, a lot of them are quilters, aren't they? And you see a lot of quilts. Quilts never come up on my Facebook. So if you want to know who you are, go through your Facebook and see who you're attracting and who you say yes and no to. And I did that. And I looked at it and I noticed, I have a strong leaning towards wildlife.
Me too.
And so I sat there and I started painting paintings, a series of paintings that were just totally, and you saw them, my deer and my Martin. I just decided that's what I want to paint. That's how I want to paint. That's it. That's my niche. Regardless of all that stuff, that's my niche. So your niche is fishermen. And the great thing about that is you can sit and look at the world. And if you look at it as a gigantic opportunity with galleries and stuff like that, it's overwhelming. In fact, it makes you kind of draw back. Especially when a lot of that crap out there has nothing to do with what you're interested in. And it doesn't mean crap like it's bad. It's just not your interest. You know, you probably don't care about wildlife. I do. I don't care about fishing. You do. But it just so happens my painting that I did has a fish in it. So there you go. My Martin, called the River Bandit. And he's standing on top of a dead fish. Yeah, so anyway. So I do like fish. Especially...
Catch and release.
No, I like them next to rice with a nice little almonds butter sauce.
Exactly.
Yeah, just don't leave the head on it. That's kind of morbid. But what's great about it is that you could sit there and go, okay, I'm going to be an artist that paints fishermen. Paint my life as fishermen. I'm going to go out and do plein air painting while I'm fishing. I don't care who else sees my. I'm going to go and find a magazine that's on fishing, and I'm going to contact them and say, hey, I'm an artist. How do I get one of my paintings on your cover? Okay? It's a lot easier to get one of your paintings on the fisherman cover than it is to try to get it on the cover of American Art. You can run ads and articles because they're always looking for, how many articles can you have on fishing? But they'll do an article on an artist that fishes. Because he could fill their magazine up with 3 or 4 pages of your images. Instant article. And it's not so scary. Because you know you're talking to the choir. They're not going to sit there and judge your work and say, well, you know, compositionally, we got 15,000 artists that paint with beautiful colors and brushstrokes, and they're bold. And they're artists. They got names. They're going to look at you and go, God, we've never had an artist contact us wanting to do the cover. That might be a good idea. Wesson Horseman has paintings on their cover a lot. And you can say, hey, look, Western Horseman, which is one of the biggest horse magazines out there, they always have, what if you guys have artists on the cover of your magazine? What would that be? And they go, let's try it. You want to do one? You could actually get a cover of a national magazine. The great thing about that is that there are a lot of rich people out there who fly fish. Because the only way they can get out of their computer world is to go out on a river and be by themselves. And they like that. And all of a sudden you pop up and they go, wow, I could be in my office looking at this painting and pretend that I'm fishing all the time. And now you have a market. See how that works? And you never have to think about painting anything. You never have to get into a gallery. You never have to get into all that mess. I have one of my students that I coach over the phone. Her big thing is maritime. She likes marine painting. And so she just thought, oh, I'll enter into an art show. They accepted her. And one of the main marine, there's like these national, like the OPA, National Artists of America, and all these different things. Well, there's one for marine artists. And she thought, well, what the hell? I'll just send one in. They accepted her, blew her away. Now, she lives like back east on the ocean. So I said, well, how is that going to work for you? And she goes, it's great because all my subjects, she says, I'm just going to be part of this community. So she got involved with some organization that works with child care or something like that. And anyway, so they were asking for donations, and it was, I think, for the fire department. And so she said, yeah, I'll participate, but I want to be able to have some paintings of the ships, you know, the fire department in the harbor, you know, where they have the... Yeah. So they said, oh, well, we could make that happen for you if you're going to donate a painting. So she went down there and she got to meet all these guys, and they set up stuff for her to take photographs. And she really is into the people who work on the boats. So she was having them do all this stuff. And then the guy who was putting it all together says, would you like to watch us pull the boats out and watch them do the water thing, the water dance? And she said, would I? So she's standing there on the beach or on the dock, and they're turning on these fountains just for her. Now she's just a little artist sitting in her studio, you know, painting, and all of a sudden she's got the fire department out there with their ships, and they went out. The whole fleet went out into the bay, and they're all spraying water. Well, what do you think happens with all the tourists in town? They're like all standing around going, whoa, what's going on? And she caused that just because she stepped into the possibility of becoming an artist. That's what happens, especially when you isolate yourself to one genre. So it's awesome that you want to paint like that. The thing that you have to do is say, that's my north. That's the direction I want to go. And your work can come out of that. Problem is, what is your north? And then how do you find that community? And everything's on the internet. You could find communities instantly. Facebook, instantly. Imagine this. Imagine that you had to choose one thing.
Yeah.
I like people, I like animals, I like, you know, nature. What is it if you were told that, if you look at a blank canvas and you had all the talent in the world, what would be, what do you envision that you could actually do the rest of your world? If a gallery came to you and said, Radha, we're going to make you the next sensation. You've got the talent, you do. Got the talent, you've got the ability, you've got the passion. We're going to turn you into worldwide, you're going to be like the Thomas Kincaid, the new Thomas Kincaid. Okay, so worldwide recognition, but we want you to paint nothing but Indian temples. You could see yourself doing that the rest of your life if you were going to find national or international fame. What do you think it would be, though? What would be your north?
Maybe a combination of the three things, because I'll put them all together.
What are they?
Well, I would probably do people in landscape or animals in landscape.
And what would they be doing?
Huh? What would they be doing?
Posing.
It's interesting because when you look at artists, they really identify themselves into markets.
Yeah, I know, but from the beginning when I started learning with you, that was not. I think you always advocated that we not then zoom in onto one thing and just be restricting ourselves. We should learn abroad. Skill set should be so that.
You can take on anything.
Yeah, exactly.
Well, and as a coach from the very beginning, that's really crucial.
That's what you said.
That you be able to paint anything, because then you can make any decision that you want.
Right. Exactly.
But if you look at artists that are really successful,
they only kind of do one thing.
Yeah. Now let's take a look at, now don't make any judgment of this, but let's look at Thomas Kincaid.
Right.
Okay. Thomas Kincaid was a fabulous painter. Mm-hmm. Could paint anything. I grew up with him. We're in the same county. We had same friends. We lived parallel lives. He's always been just a few miles from me my entire life. Yosemite, Indian scenes, plein air painting. The man was a genius. Okay, he could paint anything. He chose cottages. Why? Because cottages sell. Mm-hmm. There was actually an artist by the name, I think, Bonnie Bell, that was. If you go to antique stores up in Placerville, you'll see her. She actually did Thomas Kincaid stuff before Thomas Kincaid did. And her husband and her set up a wonderful company. And it wasn't big. It was just kind of in the gold country. And if you go to the gold country, you'll see her work scattered all over. You'll mistake them as Thomas Kincaid's. But she was first. There's a lot of people who want to do national park tours and paintings. But guess what? I was the first. You know, so being first is good, but Thomas Kincaid was better at marketing. Mm-hmm. The thing is his curse in life was that he was so popular doing cottages, and it drove him nuts because he was talented in all these other things, but the market constantly pulled him back because he built a company that needed to sell art. And so you see him trying to do plein air painting, you see him, but the thing is, what they marketed was cottages. You look at Richard Schmidt. Richard Schmidt is primarily a still life painter. He does paint portraits and he paints other things, but you pretty much, and he does landscapes. And I think he really would love to venture out and do other things. You see, he doesn't have like a still life book. He's got, his main book is actually of landscapes. But I think it's because he wants to let everybody know, hey, I just don't paint plants on or flowers on tables. You know, but he's really known for painting that so well. You know, you look at David LaFelle. Mm-hmm. You know, he tries to paint portraits and he tries to paint landscapes, but really his forte is still life. Mm-hmm. Almost every other artist that you can think of has a forte, because it's easier to market a forte. You got kind of a focus. And then get yourself out of the art market. Because the only people who are really in the art market are other artists. So like if you advertise, I think Southwest Art and all these magazines, pretty much most people who subscribe to those magazines are other artists. And you could spend a lot of money marketing your name. But imagine if Thomas Kinkade just advertised to artists, how many paintings would he sell? Who did Thomas Kinkade advertise to? No. No. Who was his main market?
The
Path of Light.
Religious.
He went after the religious market. So how they got God in a burning house, I have no idea. But everything's about the pathway of light, the God, the family, the Christian fundamental values. All of his marketing. If you read his marketing, it's all about family, religious, God. He's got a little fish underneath his signature. He's singing to the choir. And those people campaigned for him. And they weren't artists. And a lot of artists go, well, why was he so popular? Well, because he wasn't painting for other artists.
That's true.
And I have students that come in and they go, God, I want to paint a certain way. Like, I want to paint loose, like, you know, this artist or that artist. The market out there that you want to appeal to don't notice that. They liked your subject matter, and maybe they like your painting. But they couldn't tell you a loose brush stroke from a tight brush stroke. And people that can probably are not going to be buying your paintings. People who are going to buy your paintings are going to be looking at your painting going, wow, that reminds me of my honeymoon. Oh, wow, that really speaks to me because it makes me feel like my childhood. They're not going to go, wow, you're so good at doing brush strokes. Most of my collectors have no idea the difference between a planar painting and a landscape painting. They're not educated enough. And people who read those magazines, they're pretty much artists who will never buy one of your paintings. So you got to find these niches. You know, if you want to do wildlife painting, you go after bow hunters. I know you hate it, but there are a lot of wealthy bow hunters out there that will put up a painting in their corporate office of their law office that they live at. Look, Donald Trump's kids go out and kill animals on safari, right? Could they afford one of your paintings? I think so. So if you did a cougar or whatever, especially when they're trying to do for marketing, you know, it's like if they were smart and they have this reputation of going out and killing African animals, maybe behind their desk they should have a glorious painting of an elephant alive saying, no, I support animals. And this is proof. So your paintings can actually deal with corporations' identities where you least affect. How many of you would have thought to sell Donald Trump's kids a painting of an elephant? And why they might? Because they're safari painters. People who go on safaris have a lot of money. They're not cheap to go on a safari. And believe me, if they're those kind of people, they'll buy one of your paintings. And they won't care whether or not it's a planar painting. And they won't care whether or not you have good brush strokes. They'll do it because it reminds them of being on the Serengeti. And they'll go, oh man, we had a sunset just like that. I got to buy it. How much is it? Doesn't even matter. I'll buy it. So that's how you find your niche. That said, our niche today is tools. Why in the world are we painting tools? See, and Don was going, oh,
if I had a tool.
I'm not touching that.
Okay, I'm not going
to. Even if you ask me to, I won't.
Where's your tool?
But Don said, so what's the homework assignment this week? And I said, tools. And he goes, ah. Oh. After all this time, the one week I'm not here, you give kind of a manly subject matter. And I gave a manly subject matter out there because I knew he'd be in class. And then he wasn't. So if you're not in class, call me up and ask me, so what is the subject matter? So the subject matter is tools. Why? Because tools are not pretty. They can be, especially to people who are carpenters. Now, who's going to buy one of your paintings that are tools?
Carpenters.
Do you think some carpenters have money?
Some do, yeah.
How many carpenters do you think have, like, you know, because carpenters do kind of, their things are like rooms and buildings and stuff. How many of those carpenters do you think might have a man cave? You know? And how many carpenters are sick and tired of watching their wives buy floral paintings? How many carpenters do you think are out there that are able to buy a painting or would want to buy a painting of tools, of their craft? There are not that many. So if you became really good at an art, being an artist doing tools, still lives of carpenter tools, heavy-duty tools, skill saws and things like that, and do them in a way that they are presentable like a major painting that you'd see in a gallery where the wife would go, well, it's tools, but it's so good. I'll let you have it. Because that's kind of who buys the art anyway, is the wife. So I go, well, I'll let you have it. It's $1,000, but then I can buy Thomas Kincaid. So, but the thing is, there's a market out there. Guys probably wouldn't give anything to look at a painting of a daisy or a seascape. They couldn't care less, but tools? Oh, that's cool. Like you, when I said tools, you're like, oh. Oh. Men and their toys.
Finally, something to do with them.
Yes, I know. So what is it about about tools? Is that they're odd shapes? And we don't paint things. Remember, we don't paint things. So if it's of tools, I don't care. I don't want to see a painting of a hammer. Nobody needs to see that. But effects. How do you light it? How do you shadow it? How do you transition it? How do you make tools interesting to even their wives? Who sit there and go, wow, that looks really beautiful. I don't necessarily like the subject matter, but I love the way it's painted. In fact, I was showing some people some paintings, like a typewriter. I think some of you saw the typewriter. You'd never think you'd want a painting of a typewriter, but this painting of a typewriter that I have on my phone, you'd want that. You'd go, yeah, it's a typewriter, but oh my God, look at how good it is. I've never seen Marilyn bow down to a challenge.
I noticed she managed to get some flowers into the tools.
Oh, yeah.
Oh, yeah.
What? Yeah, she does have some flowers. She's her little femininity. No matter where you go, there she is. Normally, it shows up like an angel or some beautiful girl in a dress. This time, it's just a little edge in there. I like that. It's great. What were you thinking?
Flowers.
You said tools. So this, my husband gave me a toolbox when we first got married. And I have used that toolbox. I can't tell you how many times. Well, mostly for pictures and videos. I just love that little toolbox.
So your husband gave this to you when you first got married. Now, who would think that that would be the greatest wedding gift you could get from your spouse? So I think the story is great. That your husband gave it to you and you love this toolbox. And what I really love about it is, and Chris pointed this out, she says, oh, it's like framing stuff. And so it has to do with your art. So these are the little hooks. I use these a lot for mirror hooks that put your painting in the frame. For a wire, hammer, in case you hate the painting, you can hit it. Box. And then these are paintings, I assume. Mm-hmm. I like the collection of stuff. Now, one thing that I stopped at, when paintings come up here, I listen to what people say in the room. And so I heard, wow, that's a lot of stuff. And I heard somebody say, I think the same person also said, oh, it's framing stuff. And I thought, well, that's clever. That has to do with things. But ultimately, I want to hear a, ooh, because of the light. Mm-hmm. Not about the stuff. Because remember, as artists, we don't paint stuff. We paint effects. So where did you want the light to happen? What, one of these?
Yeah. The light was there. Plus, it was on the handle of the I started out with a black background. It was so muddy.
So So now could we say that that was a painting of light?
Mm-hmm. Yes. Yeah.
That light, see how everything goes into shadow?
Some more shadow.
You know, when you keep pushing light and you keep pushing light and you keep pushing light, there comes a point where you no longer have light. It just becomes flat. You have to have the contrast.
Yeah, okay.
And so the problem is that you don't have enough shadow. When you're dealing with one surface, you've got to have true shadows and true lights. The more shadows you put in, the more the light comes out. So you just don't have enough shadows to make it work.
Okay.
Yeah.
What if she glazes everything that you now have in shadows?
Yeah, that would take care of it.
That would work. Just yeah.
Now, and the thing is, you have to choose what you want, because I can move this here. Yeah, so you might like that better, because it's more in the center of the painting, more of the golden mane. So now that's a wholly different painting. But look, I just changed it. Just by changing, the effect of light, I've changed everybody's perception of it. You have total control at all times for the experience of the viewer by how you concentrate the light. And if lighting isn't that important, just look at what happened to this painting. Light is everything. How you light things, how you shadow things. If you can't get the light and you're pushing and pushing and pushing it, then go dark. Go dark with everything. That's when glazing is great. We don't want to always glaze, though. You want to be able to paint this and have this taken care of, you know, with how to paint it, not just glazing. But when in doubt, glaze it out. So anyway, so consequently, since everything's kind of all light, it kind of feels a little chalky. You know, it feels a little chalky, but easily remedied with a glaze. So, and really a gallant event, nice stuff and good idea and pertinent to being an artist. It's like you find your niche. If you were going to be a tool painter and you wanted to appeal to artists, now you have your niche. Every artist in the world knows what it's like to frame paintings. And very few people like it. That's why they always enroll their husbands into that job. Whose is this? What were you thinking?
Very difficult to set up tools and have them interesting or have them say anything.
Mm-hmm.
So when I finally got these set up, I realized, I looked at the wording on that clamp, and it said adjustable.
That's right here, it says adjustable.
Yes. And so I thought, well, that's clever, because everything there is helping things be adjustable. Clamps, pliers, and that clip.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So the painting title would be adjustable, so it told a story. And you got that story by looking at this. Mm-hmm. But you didn't get that story prior to setting it up, and you went,
no.
What does that say, adjustable? It's like, oh, wow, okay. It's an aha thing. So you never know. That's why I give these odd homework assignments. What is he thinking? I don't know. Come up with something. People think I'm crazy. I'm not. I just want you to think. And you did. I love it. And the thing is, look at how you presented that those tools. These tools belong in the garage. You took them out and put them on a white tablecloth. Do you know how many women right now are just screaming, going, no, get those tools off that white tablecloth? You've been guilty of that, right? You told your husband, what were you thinking? I just washed that. But here you are. It's like, why not tools be presented in a way that we normally don't see them? On a beautiful plate or on a white tablecloth. Beautiful lightning effect. I mean, the effects are just beautiful. They're more beautiful than the tools themselves. And we're talking about marveling over a painting of tools that you found in the garage. You'd never think about doing that. And it's beautifully done. Like I said, whenever I tell people the homework assignment, I want you to paint it as if your life depended on it. I want you to paint it in a way that you would see in a master's gallery. That you're going into the Louvre and you're going to have one of these paintings sit there. Paint it in such a way that people who walk into the room can't help but just walk across the room and look at it and bypass everything else. You know, when you go to the museum and you walk into a room where there's a sergeant, you don't even remember anything else. If you've ever seen a sergeant in a room, you will not remember what's to the left of it or to the right of it unless it's another sergeant. But anything behind you, you won't even notice. You may back up and hit a few things. Remember, the definition of sculpture is something you back into to get a better look at a painting. But anyway. This sitting across the room, I'd want to walk up and take a look at it. Marvelously done. Your homework assignment this week? Chinese takeout.